Welcome everyone. A very warm greetings from Citizen News Service, and I thank all of you for joining us on this special webinar on 30 years of HIV in India, where we will also discuss what the new WHO HIV guideline means for us. The latest WHO HIV guideline makes available two key recommendations that were developed during the revision process in 2015. The first recommendation is that antiretroviral therapy, or what we call ART, should be initiated in everyone living with HIV, irrespective of the CD4 cell count. It should be at any CD4 cell count. Second, the use of daily oral pre-exposure prophylaxis.
What we call PrEP
is recommended as a prevention choice for people with substantial risk of HIV infection as part of combination prevention approaches. It will be pertinent to mention that the next National Conference of AIDS Society of India, which is more commonly known as ACTRIMS 2015, is taking place in Mumbai between 30th October and 1st November. 30th October, 1st November. Some of this society's stalwarts have been involved since the very early stages where HIV got diagnosed in India, and we are happy that they are joining us on this webinar as well as panelists. Hand over to our moderator, the famous award-winning senior journalist Ashok Ramsuru, who is a senior producer at South African Broadcasting Corporation, that is SABC in Durban. Let me just make some questions. The first is around the questions and answers. Participants, please send us your questions while panelists are presenting using the chat function, raising the virtual hand. We will take these questions on first come first serve basis during the question and answer session. I will also make a special request to the panelists to please keep their presentations brief so we have some time for questions. Over to you, Ashok.
A greeting from the port city of Durban in South Africa. Despite having one of the highest number of people living with HIV in the world, and knowing the fact that providing antiretroviral therapy, ART, save lives and prevent HIV transmission, South Africa has only been able to provide ART to 42% of HIV-positive people. Now, 58% of HIV-positive people are yet to receive ART, according to the World Health Organization 2013 data. In India, estimated ART coverage among people living with HIV was 36% in 2013. Now, the World Health Organization has revised these HIV guidelines with two clear evidence-backed recommendations, one of which is to begin ART right away, right after testing a person positive for HIV. Now, this can be a game-changer policy if our countries act upon it. Will our countries take this evidence into account? Let us hear from our panel of experts, both of whom are veterans in the fight against AIDS in India and globally. Dr. R. Ganga Kedar is the director in charge of India's National AIDS Research Institute, and Dr. Ishwar Gilada is the president of AIDS Society of India and chair of the 2015 Conference of ASI, which begins next month in Mumbai. Both Dr. Ganga Kedar and Dr. Gilada have been there on the ground fighting AIDS since the first case was diagnosed in India in 1985. 30 years later, let's hear from them both on how can we end AIDS in India and globally. Now it's over to our esteemed guest, Dr. R. Ganga Kedar.
Yeah, I'll keep my presentation pretty short, perhaps keep more time for people to ask questions and answer them.
Great, now, great. You go ahead, sir.
Yeah, when we look at 30 years into HIV epidemic, all of us know that in 1986, the first few cases of HIV infection were detected in Chennai. Almost 30 years have elapsed since then. Our National AIDS Control Program was started in 1991-92. And initially, it only focused on offering treatment for sexually transmitted infections and opportunistic infections. And at the same time, perhaps in people in the West were offering sequential monotherapy sometime around 1992. 1994 was a landmark year for the West because they started looking at PMTCT-related intervention since the trial results of ACTG. 076 had come out with zidovudine as one of the key drugs. Then protease inhibitors were approved and led to evolution of three drug combination ART. For us in India at that time, it was only status quo. We had to keep on continuing only managing STIs and opportunistic infections. But when the first anti-HIV drug, zidovudine, was marketed in India in 1995, the costs were pretty high. But by 2000, there were waves of price reductions that came from generic pharmaceutical companies. And in September 2000, the price actually was so less that people thought that we need to utilize this opportunity to provide care to HIV-infected individuals. And at that juncture, the feasibility studies on prevention of mother-to-child transmission, which had begun in 1998-99, were already over. In 2001, government took its own initiative, putting in its own money into prevention of mother-to-child transmission program in India. And this was a different kind of a program because it also had a great element of public-private partnership as the first national program where a private sector company, Cipla, was actually providing single-dose nevirapine free of cost to as many women and children as possible all over the country. And then free ART rollout actually began in 2004. Gradually, we moved from a state of despair to perhaps a credible action that was followed by the government. And when those who developed advanced HIV disease or AIDS, as they used to call then, they used to die within 18 months. Now, they can look forward to have a longer survival despite being suffering from advanced HIV disease. Today, if you actually look at our first line scale-up, we started in 2004. Today, we have close to more than 8 lakh, that is 800,000 individuals who are currently receiving first line ART. And if you look at the graph, it has been growing almost at 45 degrees all through, which essentially means the efforts have shown its results. Wherever they could start their own ART centers in different areas, you found that new and newer patients were able to access care through these centers. Today, if you look at free ART program in India in 2015, our CD4 cutoff is at less than 350 cells. There is an option B plus for HIV infected pregnant women, which essentially means if a woman is found as HIV infected during pregnancy, she is put on ART irrespective of her CD4 counts. This ART will be continued lifelong. There is a simplified regimen of tenofovir, lamivudine, and efavirenz, which is being given both for adult management as well as during pregnancy. And there is 6-monthly immunologic monitoring. And when people suspect that the patient could have failed because of immunologic failure, targeted plasma viral load is used to confirm that particular failure. However, when you look at second-line ART, which is also provided free of cost by the government, the program was started in 2008. But as of 2014, when the figures are available, there are only about 8,500 patients who are actually receiving second-line ART. When you look at the recent developments that have occurred elsewhere, we had data from START, Temprano, and HPTN-052, for which my own institution had also participated and contributed significantly, they have led to a recommendation of treat all approach by WHO. There are various PrEP studies that have also added another approach in combination approach for prevention, which is also recognized as of now. Now the question that comes is, can we plan implementation of these approaches that have been advocated by World Health Organization? If you actually look at what kind of infrastructure we have, all of us know India is one of the largest countries in terms of population. We have almost 1/6 of the population staying in India of the world. Now, if you look at where we are, we have close to about 516 ART centers in India. There are 976 link ART centers, and these link ART centers are expected to take care of those patients who have received ART from an ART center and are stable in the first 6 months. Then they are gradually shifted to a link ART center which is close by their own residential place. And here we have 976 link ART centers which are providing almost 76,000 patients the ART related services as of October 2014. There are 350 care and support centers which have also been established in the country. There are close to 5,100 integrated counseling and testing centers for enhancing the access to testing, which if you actually look at the numbers itself, they will tell you a story that the program has been able to develop a massive infrastructure to match the treatment needs of the people. Despite all this, there are going to be some key challenges to overcome if India tends to adopt the treat all kind of an approach and combination prevention approach using even PrEP. We need to look at sustaining linkages with free ART program, enhancing access to treatment in low HIV prevalence states, which are highly populous in India, ensuring timely access to second line ART, providing services to mobile population of migrants, enhancing coverage to key population groups of sex workers, MSM, and injecting drug users, ensuring quality supply chain management in a large country for antiretroviral drugs, as well as the test kits, is something which is going to be a crucial challenge. If we try and look at some of the slides, if you are able to see them, sustaining linkage in free ART program, we have close to about 2 million estimated HIV infections. 1.6 million people have ever been registered at ART centers, but when it comes to starting on ART, there are close to only 1 million people who have been started on ART. And when you look at the number of those who are alive and on ART, it's close to about 800,000 people, which means there is some kind of either duplication in terms of the numbers that are being reported for ever registered in ART centers, or there is a true attrition that is occurring over a period, and that's something which we need to overcome after doing situation analysis very well. If you look at how we may be able to enhance our coverage, one issue that I already told, that we may have to offer these services in low prevalence states. And if you look at the epidemic that we have in India, there are four states, that is Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Maharashtra, and Tamil Nadu, which contribute 55% of HIV infections. And when it comes to treatment, 71% of those who are receiving ART are coming from these four states, which essentially means that if I have to go to other states, perhaps the cost effectiveness of establishing a center could be compromised to some extent, and we need to have some kind of a strategy which will not only be cost effective, perhaps it will also be able to enhance the access to testing as well as treatment services in these low prevalence states. And that is classically seen in the map that you are seeing here. You find in those highly populous states, you have low prevalence districts, and to provide services related to ART where cost effectiveness could be compromised is going to remain as a major challenge. The yellow districts are those which are low prevalence districts, and they are essentially in the low HIV prevalence states as such. Another issue that we need to recognize is, though we have close to about 800,000 people receiving first-line ART, that these people, you would perhaps, in last 10 years, you would expect that the numbers on second-line should have been high enough. But when it comes to second-line ART, we find that there are only about 8,500 people who are receiving second-line ART, which means we may need to ensure that all those who fail on first line are offered targeted viral load in time and they are linked to second line ART program efficiently. If that happens, perhaps we will find that the survival on ART would also improve dramatically. And what is also important for us to recognize is the slide classically shows that migrants are one of the major drivers of the epidemic today. And there is another challenge that comes with migration as a driver, and that is these people tend to be highly mobile. And if they are mobile, then offering treatment services can become extremely challenging because they may be receiving ART at one center. You may have to ensure that when they move for economic reasons from one place to another, they would still be able to ensure that they would be adhering to the treatment by accessing ART from another center, and how that would happen is a challenge that we need to address over a period of time now. In conclusion, despite being a large country, India has developed a huge infrastructure for provision of ART-related services. Free antiretroviral therapy has been scaled up rapidly and has improved survival. Strengthening ART centers for treat-all approaches to ensure that the number of patients per healthcare provider or a counselor should become small enough so that they can offer them services of quality is something which is going to be a major challenge. Though there are many challenges, these challenges can be overcome with a progressive, flexible approach in developing strategies. And I'm sure that in a country which was never used to handle these kinds of chronic diseases, what we have shown over the last 30 years is that we can take up this challenge as well. We can be extremely progressive and dynamic when it comes to changing our strategies and developing our strategies. If that is true, if the past has shown something positive, let us hope that the future will also hold promises of controlling HIV infection in India. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Doctor. That was Dr. R. Ganga Kedar, who is the Director in Charge of National AIDS Research Institute of Indian Council of Medical Research. Well, moving on, we have another important guest whom I was fortunate to meet, Dr. Ishwar Gilada, who is the President of the AIDS Society of India and chair of the 2015 National Conference of ASI, which begins next week in Mumbai. Well, Dr. Gilada have been on the ground fighting AIDS as a clinical scientist and activist for the past 30 years. And well, he's now going to share and give us his reflections on the pandemic. Hello.
Now I'll try and tell what I also feel like. Now, most of the drugs that we are currently using, they are effective, there is no doubt, but they tend to have more toxicity. Unfortunately, all these drugs which we are using as simplified regimen are likely to go out of use in the developed world pretty soon. We really do not know how that transition from our low-cost drugs to those drugs which are likely to be perhaps costlier is going to happen in public health programming. But they have improved survival and quality of life immensely elsewhere. We really don't know. Hello.
What is the survival? What's the survival rates of AIDS patients really, in general?
See, most of the data has come from 1995 on. So we have hardly seen 20 years of use of combination antiretroviral therapy. Therefore, the only way to know how long the person will survive depends on statistical modeling. And when people did statistical modeling, they found that any individual at the age of 30, if he doesn't have hepatitis C infection, which can perhaps have higher mortality if it is a co-infection that we are likely to observe, you know, the person can aspire to survive close to about 75 years of age if he has access to antiretroviral therapy. So it essentially means that a HIV infected individual is more likely to see almost similar lifespan as somebody who is HIV negative, except for the fact that he has to consume those medicines. Hello.
Doctor, what I want to also know is that, yeah, doctor, I'm listening, very, very invaluable. Is Dr. Gilada online?
Not doctor? Yet. No, not yet.
Okay, okay. What I also want to ask you, doctor, you know, there's a strong distinction between HIV/AIDS and TB. For the ordinary, for a layman to understand the dynamics of the whole thing, perhaps you can give us a little understanding of this, of these diseases.
No, TB is caused by a bacteria, Mycobacterium tuberculosis. TB has an effective treatment as long as the patient consumes medicines. Perhaps he needs to only take it for a far shorter a period compared to HIV, and the person can be completely cured. The only problem that you by and large see is these drugs tend to be a little toxic, and as human beings we have another tendency. We tend to take tablets regularly only when we are sick. The moment our health starts improving, people tend to default, and they assume that even if I develop drug resistance to some of these medicines, I will still be able to take some other antibiotics in its place, which is not true for TB. If there is a multi-drug resistant tuberculosis, the likelihood of death increases so much, and you need to take the treatment almost for 2 years period and face all kinds of side effects. That's something which is not advisable. So essentially, if we have to control TB, we need to ensure that the people will be able to adhere to the treatment and they will complete the treatment by taking it regularly. Otherwise, HIV and TB, perhaps TB should be one which should be very easily controlled, which doesn't happen because people don't take treatment on time.
I have a question for Dr. Ganga Kit.
Yeah.
Can you hear me, doctor?
Yeah, yeah.
Yes. By when can we expect that in India we will be able to follow the first recommended guideline issued by WHO recently, that everyone who is HIV positive is put on ART irrespective of CT4 cell count? Do we ever see this happening in India, or what are the challenges?
I can answer the second part first. Yes, we should be in a position to offer treatment for all. The question is, when can we offer treatment for all? Perhaps that answer should be given by the officials at National AIDS Control Organization, but I can say only one thing. Since if we put people on treat all strategy, we'll first need to buy stocks of drugs before we offer them. If we have to buy additional stocks of drugs, then in that case it should take at least 6 months to 1 year from the date when we change our guidelines. But I only hope that it will still be possible in India. It may still take 1 year's time.
All right. One more question about on the second guidelines. What about using PrEP in India? Are there any suggestions on that, or is there any thought given to using PrEP also as part of the package? Have any demonstration studies taken place, or are they about, or should they be taking place? Yes.
There is a demonstration project on PrEP, which is likely to start in a couple of months' time. It will be done among sex workers in Sonaghachi and also sex workers in Mysore. So that will be a demonstration study that will happen. There are talks that a similar kind of demonstration project could also be started among men having sex with men in a couple of sites in India.
So it's only after that a decision would be taken on that, after getting the results of the studies.
That's right.
Anyone asking any more questions? I'm asking the participants to please send in their questions if there are any. Because I think Dr. Gilada is still having some trouble with technology there. Also, Dr. Ganga Khedkar, I would like to know, as of now, what is the average CD4 count at which an HIV patient is coming for a treatment or to be on ART? Is it very low? Means
in terms of our mean CD4 counts, if we calculate mean for the entire country, we are far better off than many other countries. Our CD4 count is beyond 210 at initiation of ART. So we have made better progress in that area. Hello?
Hello, yes, all right. Okay. But as you said, and I understand that for pregnant women, there is like ART started irrespective of CD4 count, is it?
CD4, yeah.
I am again requesting the participants to send their questions using chat function or raising the virtual hand, because we are still waiting for Dr. Gilada.
And in the meanwhile, should I check with him what is happening?
Yes, if you can ask him.
Yeah.
Okay. There is a question from a journalist, Dr. Richa Sharma. She wants to know, given the statistics of the current number of people living with HIV and the number of people actually on ART, how difficult will you think it will be for a low resource setting to implement the new guidelines with reference to early initiation of ART?
No, early initiation of ART is going to be challenging. That's why I listed out some of the challenges that we may have to overcome. But one needs to just look at one issue. No, we have been able to handle 800,000 patients effectively on ART in India within a short space of time. When you have infrastructure in place, to meet these challenges would be comparatively easier than if we did not have any kind of infrastructure. So it is essentially an issue that we may need to take decisions am I worried about being somebody from low resource country? Perhaps not. The cost is also coming down low and lower for all these antiretroviral drugs. Hello.
Yes, and as long as we have people like Dr. Ganga Khedkar at the helm of affairs, we can always expect things to improve and improve. I have a lot of faith in. So, Dr. Ganga Khedkar, are you contacting Dr. Gelada or do you think?
Yeah, he actually called just now and told me that when he goes on the website, it is not taking him to the webinar. I don't know why.
Okay.
So I asked him to redo it again.
Okay. These are the glitches of technology. And Dr. Ganga Khedkar, I think you had to catch a flight.
You
are in a hurry to leave. You can, because we are very grateful to you for having found time for this. And it is always so encouraging to hear you speak, always for me. And I'm sure others have really enjoyed interaction with you. And very sorry to the other people for IT glitches. And thank you, Dr. Ganga Khedkar. Thank you very much for being there. We don't want you to miss your flight because of us.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.